Want to thank everybody for being here on a beautiful day and stuck inside here, but we're going to make it fun. I got a great story to tell you about St. Louis and the Olympic movement itself. Does anybody know how many American cities have hosted an Olympics? Anyone? a couple ringers out there, I see. So the six cities that have hosted them are Los Angeles, Lake Placid, Squaw Valley, Salt Lake, Atlanta, and us. And we were America's first. They were the third Olympics. The two before us was Athens and Paris. And the question is, but originally, the third Olympics, they wanted it to go to London. Why did they end up in America? How did St. Louis get them? And ultimately help save the Olympic movement? And how did a outcast teenager whose dad was basically the Bernie Madoff of the day factor into all this? So let's get into the story. So it's basically a tale of two adversaries. Jim Sullivan, who is the head of the American Athletic Union, and Pierre de Coubertin, who is a baron and founder of the modern Olympics. The two men were born 6 weeks apart, but they could not have been more different. Two commonalities they had: they were both patriots, Sullivan to America, Coubertin to France, and beyond that, they wanted to see the Olympics successful, but without the other person involved. So, in essence, they hated each other. Jim Sullivan was a tall, athletic, blunt individual who never minced words. He grew up in the Irish slums of New York a year into the Civil War. His parents were Irish immigrants. And he, in essence, he despised Europe's aristocracy. He believed people should be judged by their merits and not by their bloodline. The sports culture in America was just starting. This, and actually just a quick side note, this baseball player, Boston, is Albert Spalding, as in Spalding Sporting Goods, and he was the one who popularized wearing a baseball mitt on people's hands. Back then they were called the Boston Bean Eaters, by the way. So the sports culture in America was just beginning. Prior to the Civil War, Puritanism kind of ran the day, and you either worked or you prayed, and there was no time to leisure. And if you finished your work early and maybe had an hour where you could do some leisure activities, you didn't do that. You prayed, and thank God that you had an extra hour to pray. After the Civil War, industrialization started, and new inventions happened that allowed, kind of freed up people and gave them more time for leisure activity. There was a new wave of immigrants coming to America who didn't care to spend their entire Sunday praying and resting. They wanted to have fun. So sports started to become a thing. And three of the popular sports at the time were professional baseball, college football, and amateur athletics, which were organized and controlled by the elite athletic clubs in America, one of them being our Missouri Athletic Club here in town. Mark Twain, our legendary Mark Twain, was stated that sports became the symbol of the raging, tearing, booming 19th century. And Jim Sullivan saw sports as his way out of the slums. He got a job at a local magazine and started one of America's first sports columns. So it was very innovative of him. Now, on the flip side, Baron Coubertin, he was short. He was kind of highbrow. He was a French gentleman who went out of his way not to offend people, unlike Sullivan's blunt manner. He was born to wealthy aristocrats who had several estates across France. But he was the third son. And per French inheritance laws, the first two sons got pretty much all the titles and all the land. So he was given a modest trust and basically expected to either go into politics or law or science or the military. But something affected Coubertin when he was 7 years old that he never forgot. In 1870, the German army marched into France, took over the fertile lands of Alsace-Lorraine, and made Napoleon III surrender to them. And it was a humiliation that Coubertin never got over. The French had grown soft, he knew it, and he wanted to do something to restore his beloved France to a first-rate power. Especially with the constant threat of Germany on their borders, which he knew was just a matter of time before they invaded again. So Coubertin, oh, this is Napoleon. So Coubertin looks to the British Empire. The British Empire is the biggest empire in the world. They cover a fourth of the globe. And the British Empire is also the father of modern sports. They have the greatest athletes in the world. They were the ones who defeated Napoleon at Waterloo. And it was said that their soldiers' great military prowess began on their school's sporting fields. So to Coubertin's family's horror, he devotes himself to bringing sports to the French schools, an activity the French view as frivolous and, frankly, kind of Anglo-Saxon and, well, not French. So nobody in France is really into sports. In 1890, though, Coubertin gets an invitation from an individual by the name of Dr. William Pennybrooks from England. He lives in a small village called Mucksh Winlock, and they have been putting on a local Olympics festival for almost half a century. Coubertin comes, and they show him their Olympic festival, and Dr. Pennybrooks is getting very old at this point, and he wants to pass the torch to somebody. He's been trying to get a modern Olympics started in Greece for the past 50 years to no avail. And eventually, he convinces Coubertin that this is a good idea. So Coubertin is getting nowhere trying to convince the French to strengthen themselves through sport. And he thinks, well, if I can't get strength through sport, maybe we can get peace through international athletics by bringing Germany and France together and kind of getting a better understanding of one another. So his thought of the Olympics is more peaceful than competitive. Coubertin then shares his vision with a friend named Bill Sloan, who's a French professor at Princeton University. And Sloan invites Coubertin to come to New York and share his great idea with America's top athletic leaders, one of them being Jim Sullivan. Coubertin comes, and all the Americans are like, nah, it just sounds stupid. International competition is kind of strange. It's not easy to travel. It's very costly to travel. It's very time-consuming to travel. There's no way to raise money for this stuff. And there's no radio, so newspapers and getting even that information across seas is very difficult. So it just sounds kind of dumb to Sullivan, and he basically tells Coubertin that it will be an inevitable failure. So, which doesn't exactly go to their friendship. So Coubertin goes to London, and he gets even worse reception over there. London is the father of modern sports, and there's no way they're letting some Frenchie tell them how sports should be run, especially in some international competition. Charles Herbert, who's the head of the Athletic Association over there, tells Coubertin the games will neither be viable nor useful. Says they have no interest, and he said if any athlete wants to compete against the greatest in the world, all they have to do is come to Great Britain's annual sports championships and compete. Britain's not going anywhere. So Coubertin makes one more Hail Mary at this. He gathers a group of international academics, sportsmen, past and future Nobel Prize winners, and invites them all to the Sorbonne. And he gives this big rousing speech about why the Olympics are so great, and crickets. So he's getting nowhere. So he thinks about what Dr. Pennybrooks tried to do with Greece, and he reaches out to the Greeks as a last resort. And he appeals to them. The Greeks really have no interest in sports, but they are interested in glorifying Greece. So Coubertin appeals to their patriotism, say this is going to be great. We're going to, you know, give a rebirth of the glory of Greece through these Olympics. And he convinces Prince Constantine and a very wealthy Greek, George Averoff, to bankroll the games and refurbish the old ancient Greek stadium. So here's the old stadium. I just want to note, this is about a 200-meter track and with a very hairpin turn that no runner would ever want to be running on. It doesn't lead to the greatest times. But anyway, this is the ancient Greek stadium. So the Greeks are all in. And they give, you know, they're all about the celebration of Greece. They really don't care about the sports. But Athens is hard to reach, unfortunately. It's costly. Just from Europe, you have to take several trains and several boats to get there. America, it takes 3 weeks to get to Athens. So there are no national Olympic committees to organize or help sponsor this. The athletes who come are self-selected and come on their own dime. The world's top athletes pretty much don't come. There are around 70 athletes from 13 foreign nations who come to the games, and the rest of the 241 Olympians are all Greek. They're all male, and they have 43 events. Some of these events, 12 of them are track and field, and there's a hodgepodge of others. They do put on the first marathon, which is 25 miles at the time. They have swimming, but their swimming is more like take a boat out to the Greek Sea, we're gonna dump you in and just swim back to shore. And the Greek Sea is freezing, waves are really high, and as one victorious swimmer said, it became more about surviving than winning. So the Greeks, the Greeks give out for their prizes, they give out two medals, silver and copper, okay? And they give out, if you win, you get a olive branch from Olympus on your head and you get a diploma. There's no prize for third place. The Americans, so Coubertin friends Bill Sloan convinces 13 Americans from Princeton and around the Boston area with money who can go over there and compete. So 13 Americans go, and to everybody's surprise, they win nine of the 12 track events. Well, word of this gets back to Sullivan. Now Sullivan's interested. He's like, if our, you know, mediocre athletes can go over there and win, what would happen if our top athletes went to the Olympics? And, you know, again, Britain didn't really send anybody over there either, so it wasn't a good picture. But Sullivan, being the patriot, is all hopped up. Now he wants to show America's greatness through the Olympics. And so this kind of, he sees the Olympics as kind of a world stage on a bloodless battlefield to bring America to prominence on the national stage and announce ourselves as a world power. So he reaches out to his friend, Albert Spaulding, who we saw earlier, who now has a big sporting goods store. And Spaulding's a big patriot too. And again, Sullivan sells him on the big us versus the Brits. We're gonna take down the Brits. And Albert's all in. So they raise money for a team to send to the 1900 Olympics in Paris. Now, Coubertin is envisioning the 1900 World's Fair Paris Olympics as the Olympics' big coming out party. The fair is looking at seeing maybe 50 million people come in, and the fair's committee is looking to find a symbol that will match the 1889 World's Fair Eiffel Tower. So Coubertin pitches them on the first modern day stadium that would rival even the old Roman Colosseum. And this will be the great Olympic coming out party. Well, again, he's pitching to a bunch of French who just love sports. So anyway, so America ends up sponsoring 53 track and field athletes. Britain's attitude remains, hey, anybody wants to compete against the best athletes in the world, they could come to England and compete in our British championships. A few British top athletes do come on their own shilling, but it was not organized by the Brits. So the Paris Olympics actually turns out to be a disaster. So instead of building a grand stadium, the World's Fair Committee just decides to paint the Eiffel Tower yellow as their big symbol. They don't even use the name Olympic. Again, they don't see sports as a viable thing. The Olympic events are indistinguishable from other athletic events like cannon firing, pigeon racing, firefighting, delivery truck driving, and kite racing. So not very good. They don't have a stadium, so they send the athletes out to a field outside Paris. It has trees, it's uneven, they mark off kind of a makeshift trough for the hammer throwers and discus throwers. They have to throw around a big oak tree in the middle of the field. They have no stands for spectators, not that they needed any because nobody came. And Coubertin even says, there's nothing could be more difficult than trying to persuade a number of French spectators to attend a sports meeting. So, and to reiterate, these were an absolute disaster. One of the few highlights, ironically, was swimming. So they swam in the River Seine. Again, they had a current which juiced up their times. But most of Brit's top swimmers show up, and they clean up. They win everything. We had one American tourist who was there who thought it'd be kind of fun to try to compete, and he didn't make it out of the first heat. So, again, the Brits, again, pound their chest and say, nobody can beat us, and go back to England. And the winners of these Paris Games, they just receive a hodgepodge of awards, from copper and silver medals to silver cups and bowls. And one swimmer even received a 50-pound bronze statue of a horse. So go figure that one out. So basically all the athletes and anybody athletic there says the Paris Olympics are a huge joke. And in fact, many could argue if these Olympics even occurred at the level they should have. So Coubertin even confides in a friend that there was nothing Olympic about them and said it would be a miracle if the Olympic movement survives after 1900 Paris. All right, so here sets the stage for Jim Sullivan. So Jim Sullivan believes in the Olympics, but without Pierre Coubertin, who he deems as just an ineffective leader. So he stages a coup to try to get the Olympics under his own leadership. Doesn't work. He wants to bring them to the 1901 Buffalo World's Fair, and he only wants track and field. Everything else he thinks is inconsequential, like swimming, all that stuff, just superfluous. And he wants to hold them annually. Well, to fend off Sullivan, Coubertin reaches out to London and says, please, will you take the 1904 Olympics? London has all the credibility, and they could give credibility to the Olympics. Well, Charles Hubert says, your Olympics would be a frost, pure and simple. We don't want them. So America is now the only country interested in keeping the movement alive. So to thwart Sullivan, again, it looks like Sullivan's going to get him for Buffalo. But to thwart Sullivan, Coubertin reaches out to a friend at the University of Chicago and says, look, put a bid in, and I will give you the Chicago Olympics for 1904. And they make a big to-do. The University of Chicago is a big bonfire celebration, and it kind of stifles Sullivan. So he's furious. So now the Olympics are set to be in Chicago in 1904. Well, what happens? One person has a say in this. So the St. Louis World's Fair was originally scheduled for 1903. That was the 100th anniversary of the Louisiana Purchase Expedition. But construction overruns caused it in 1902 to be announced that it would be put off to 1904. Well, once this happens, David Francis sets in. And David Francis was not only the former mayor of St. Louis, he was the former governor of Missouri. He was also a WashU alum. And he is now the president of the World's Fair. The World's Fair was all his vision. And he plans to put on a sports exhibition at the World's Fair. And there is no way he's letting another international sporting event happen during the 1904 World's Fair. So he decides he's going to bring the Olympics to St. Louis. Already, they're planning to build a huge modern-day stadium, which they do at WashU University. For those of you interested, that stadium is still there, and it is the oldest modern-day Olympic stadium in the world right now. So, again, David Francis decides to bring the Olympics to St. Louis, but Chicago has them. So what does he do? Well, he basically puts the squeeze on Chicago. He says, look, all the money and all the funding is coming to St. Louis. At the time, 60% of the United States was still rural, and they had planned with all the railroads to direct all the trains to St. Louis. And his ace in the hole was Jim Sullivan. So he had already gotten Jim Sullivan to agree that the amateur athletic union championships would be held in St. Louis in 1904. And what they did was Sullivan reached out to Chicago and said, all the athletes, all the greatest athletes in America are coming to St. Louis, and they will not be allowed to compete at the Chicago Olympics. So once this happened, the nail was in the coffin. And Chicago conceded, and the games went to St. Louis. Now, Coubertin is just beside himself. The Olympics are already on life support. And here, now they're going to his mortal enemy to save. Now, the one thing Coubertin does, and what's even worse is, David Francis appoints Jim Sullivan as the World's Fair Director of Physical Culture, which also puts the Olympic Games under him. So now Coubertin is just like, oh, this is it. It's over. Nothing's going to happen. But he does do one thing, Coubertin. He makes Sullivan promise that any international sporting events be under the Olympic name. So Sullivan can't just take track and field and just say that's the Olympics. But those, it's now up to the individual athletic organizations to put on their international championships outside of track and field. So who does that go to? Well, people like Dwight Davis, as we know, is the Davis Cup. He's a St. Louisan. He's put in charge of tennis. Albert Bon Lambert's family started Listerine. Albert was one of the early, in fact, he got his pilot's license from Wilbur and Orville Wright. He was one of the first airplane flyers. We know Lambert Field is named after him. He's put in charge of golf. Why golf? He starts Glen Echo Country Club, which is where it was played. And Albert is also an avid golfer who actually participated in the 1900 Paris Olympic golf match. And swimming is put in the hands of Alex Meffert. Alex was from New York. The MAC had just opened. They recruited him to come to St. Louis to be in charge of their swimming and swimming activities. And Alex is put in charge to organize the Olympic swimming events, which he finds an interesting place to put them, which we'll talk about in a minute. So at this point, the American public is introduced to the Olympics really for the first time. It's covered in all the national papers. People are trying to get, Sullivan's trying to get people excited about it, excited about sports, excited about these international competitions. They introduce, at WashU, they build the first Olympic gymnasium. They introduce track lines. These have never been done before, so the audience can follow them a little better. They introduce signage at athletic events. They even have the first Olympic stadium announcer. At the Olympics, they also debut Olympic diving, boxing, freestyle wrestling, the decathlon, and basketball. And the biggest contribution St. Louis made to the Olympics is we start the gold medal. So we're the birthplace of the gold medal. It was the first time gold, silver, and bronze was awarded in an Olympic event. And guess what? Britain refuses to come. And Coubertin refuses to come. Nor does he make any effort to send any French athletes. Not that there's that many, but they don't come either. So Sullivan has to work his contacts. Now, because the French aren't coming and because the British aren't coming, well, the Germans are like, we'll come. And because the English aren't coming, the Irish are like, we'll come. And they're happy to compete under an Irish flag for the first time. So again, it's one of the biggest foreign athletes on American soil. 121 foreign athletes compete with the 651 Olympics, which is about twice as many as Athens. Some of the highlight Olympians, George Pogue, who was born in Hannibal, Missouri, to his parents were former slaves. He becomes the first African-American to win a medal. He wins two bronze in the 200 and 400 hurdles. Another Olympian is George Iser, who had a wooden leg. He's living in St. Louis at the time, and he wins six Olympic medals in gymnastics. For those of you who don't know, St. Louis was one of the early gymnastics hubs. We had a big German population here, us in Cincinnati, and gymnastics came from Germany, and it was a big social gathering place, too. So we had a huge gymnastics hub here, and George was one of the top gymnastics at the time. Two others, Ray Urey, who competed in three Olympics, won eight Olympic gold medals total. He won three here in St. Louis. He did what was called the standing jump, where you literally just stood and jumped. In Paris, they called him the human frog because he could jump so high from a standing position. The other Olympian was Matilda Howe, who you could see did archery, and she was at the time acknowledged as America's first female to win a gold medal. Decades and decades later, a woman by the name of, her name was Margaret Abbott, who competed in the Paris Golf, and she received a silver bowl when she won, but it wasn't deemed an Olympic event until after she had passed away in 1955. So she lived all her life never knowing that she had competed in an Olympic event. And the other interesting thing, obviously, is the marathon. So there's a lot of humorous stories around this, some true, some not. So I just want to talk a little bit about that so we can dispel some of the falsehoods and understand some of the truths. Now, the Olympic marathon took place on August 30th. It was just under 25 miles. There were 32 starters. It was in 90-degree plus heat and humidity here in St. Louis. There were only two places along the route for water, the 6-mile mark and the 12-mile mark. There was like this old well that they could draw from. And Jim Sullivan had wanted to minimize fluid intake because he was curious to test the limits and effects of purposeful dehydration, which was like a scientific study back then. So it was basically Olympic marathon was for guinea pigs here. There were cars at the time, and they were carrying coaches and physicians, and they motored alongside the runners, kept up about the same pace, and these were on dirt roads, and the cars were kicking up ridiculous dust. One Olympic marathoner actually collapsed because he had inhaled so much dust, and it was strangling his esophagus, and he had to be taken to the hospital. A marathoner was Frank Pierce, who was the first Native American Olympian, which kind of set the stages for Jim Thorpe in 1912. There were several South American participants who were working at the fair and just decided to join in on the marathon and actually ran in bare feet. Felix Carbajal was from Cuba, and he was a Cuban mailman who raised money to come over here to compete. He was a very good runner, but when he got over to New Orleans, he lost it all playing dice. And then had to hitchhike to St. Louis. And at one point, the story is he was running in the race and actually had a lead, got a little hungry, went to found an apple tree and ate some rotting apples and got sick and had to lay over on the side of the road for a while until his stomach cramps subsided and then resumed the race. I think he finished fourth, by the way. Tom Hicks, who was the perennial American favorite for these, came under the care of two men around the 10th mile mark because he didn't have any water, and he was begging them for a drink, and they're like, no, it'd be bad for you. So they would give him like a little sponge droplets of water, and he's just dying. At about 7 miles from the finish, they decided it'd be a good idea to give him strychnine and egg whites, which was the first recorded instance of drug use in the Olympics. Strychnine in small doses was commonly used as a stimulant back then, and at the time, there were no rules about performance-enhancing drugs, so it didn't really matter. They also had a flask of brandy that they were willing to give him, but never got to that point. But the one interesting story that always comes out of it is about the marathon runner who got a ride in a car halfway through, and the car drove him to about a couple miles outside the stadium, and he jumped out and went into the stadium. The crowd erupted. He was the first one to enter. He broke the finish line. Alice Roosevelt gave him a wreath, was just about to, and people said, wait, he cheated. That's not really true. So the guy did. His name was It was Fred Lors. And Fred was actually a very good runner. And he did, about 10 miles in, he did get a ride with his trainer and the judge. There was a judge in just about every car. So they knew he was disqualified. Although he did drive back by Hicks, who was dying of thirst. And he saw this guy go by. And he's like, hey, that's not fair. But again, he was already disqualified. The car did kind of break down, and Lors decided to run to the stadium. He did go into the stadium. He did get a loud ovation, but before he even crossed the finish line, he kind of called over and said, hey, I'm not official. Alice Roosevelt was never at the World Fair that day. She did go, but she was never there that day, so that story is completely made up. And the one thing about Lors, too, he ended up winning the Boston Marathon the next year. So, again, he was a very good runner. But Hicks got the gold medal for the marathon and suffered as a result. I think probably had to be hospitalized afterwards. But anyway, so that's the story of the St. Louis Marathon. Now, the other big event that needs to be talked about was the swimming here. Now, again, it was put in charge by Alex Meffert, who was the coach of the Missouri Athletic Club swimmers. They couldn't put it at the Missouri Athletic Club because their pool was basically in a basement. If you saw it, it looked like it was in a basement. It was dank. It was dark. There was no place really for spectators. So they decided to put it at the life-saving lake. For those of you who are familiar with Forest Park, the life-saving lake is now, I think, is it the Presbyterian Church across the street, I believe it is, which is right in the category of Wash U. But that's where it was, and that's also where you could see the big Ferris wheel was. Now, the funny, ironic thing about life-saving lake was it was also by the Palace of Agriculture. And a lot of the livestock used to go in there and defecate in the lake. So not the greatest place to be swimming in, okay? So not only do these swimmers in the day, you could see they're on a wooden, basically dock buoyed by barrels. They don't have goggles. They're swimming in wool clothes. The lake is completely dark. I mean, swimming back in the day didn't have chlorine, so it wasn't anything they weren't exactly used to. So they're used to swimming in these kind of conditions. And again, England does not show up. So the greatest swimmers in the world who have a dynasty of 75 years, never been beaten, they don't show up. They're like, it's not worth our time or effort. There's no honor in beating a bunch of Americans who are regarded typically as one of the worst swimmers in the world. But the B team, the European B team, does show up. And that's the Germans, the Hungarians, Austrians. And the swimming is set for 3 days. And surprisingly, the crowd is enormous. One of the reasons, at this time, you have to understand, nobody in America swam. There were 600 registered swimmers in the entire country. There was only about a dozen swimming pools in the entire country. There's a reason for that, but we won't get into it. But nobody swam. And the only reason that people got interested was because there was the biggest disaster in New York history, other than 9/11, happened about 6 months before these games, before the swimming trials. Actually, 4 months before. And it was called the General Slocum. And it was a steamship that was just on a pleasure cruise with a bunch of women and children who were on a church outing. There was about 1,400 of them aboard, and the vessel caught fire. And it was within probably 50 yards of the shore, but nobody knew how to swim. The life jackets fell apart in their hands. They were just poorly done, and 1,200 people ended up drowning that day. It shocked America to attention, and suddenly we started getting interested in swimming. So that sets the stage for the swimming matches. Again, we have nobody that good except for one person. His name is Charles Daniels. He is the teenager whose father was kind of the Bernie Madoff of the day. He got caught up in a huge Wall Street swindling ring. His father had walked out on he and his mother 4 years before it happened. He and his mother were living very simply, borderline poverty, and he looked at swimming as a way to get his name back, to make a name for himself. So the first day of swimming, we get annihilated. We don't win a thing. It all goes to the Europeans. But the second day, Charles Daniels, in the 200-meter race, not only wins gold, but breaks the British record. This gets their attention. And the Brits, of course, are like, no way, didn't happen, he cheated, wasn't fair, not good timing, anything like that. But Charles Daniels ends up winning 5 medals at these Olympics, 3 gold, 1 silver, 1 bronze. And now America starts getting interested in swimming. And Jim Sullivan also starts mouthing off a little bit, too, and says, look, even if the British came to the United States, the American track and field athletes still would have annihilated them. So now the gauntlet's been thrown, and the Brits take the bait. So they want to host the 1908 Olympics. So the stage is set. Now, Charles Daniels goes on to invent the freestyle stroke. He ends up starting the U.S. Olympic swimming team. He takes us from being the worst swimming country to now having the greatest Olympic dynasty in history, winning more gold medals than the next 11 countries combined. But how does that happen? Well, it's all at the 1908 Games. So the stage is set. So everything comes down between Sullivan and Coubertin, between London and England, and between Charles Daniels and the entire British swim team. And since we're only talking about really the St. Louis Olympics, we're not going to go into this. But if you are interested in it, there is a really good book called The Watermen that talks all about it. And I will give you a little teaser about Charles Daniels. At the 1908 Games, so Charles Daniels gets really good at coming off the walls and swimming. And the Brits are so upset by this, they design a 100-meter swimming pool at the Olympic Games. So Charles Daniels can't turn and get that advantage from them. Not only that, but the Brits stack it with British judges, British timekeepers, and on the gold medal round, they don't use a shotgun. They say, on your mark, get set, go, which they always did over in Britain. They always did throughout the Olympics. But in the gold medal round, they tell all the swimmers except Charles Daniels, we're going to go, on your mark, go. And Charles Daniels was taking off his robe when they made the call. So again, it's an amazing story. And if you're at all interested, again, I think they have the Watermen upstairs, and I'll be happy to sign books and talk to anybody. about the Olympics. So thank you for coming.